Ham Radio Now from the Huntsville Ham Fest. Once again, I am Gary Pierce, KN4AQ, and we are going to talk TAPR and digital stuff. And sitting across the table is a regular, perhaps one of my most regular people here on Ham Radio Now, and the old ARVN, Mel Whitten, K0PFX.
Glad to be with you.
You have been designated as the TAPR spokesperson for this interview, because Steve Bible's not here.
Right.
And he felt his picture was too fuzzy on Skype. So he said, just have Mel do it. He'd be happy to. So
okay, I'll do what I can.
We got the TAPR conference coming up last third of September.
Yeah, the 32nd one. And the last time we had it in Seattle, it's in Seattle, Washington this year, was in 1996, so we're due back to the Northwest.
Yeah. Now, they move those conferences. This is the Digital Communications Conference. They move those conferences central, east, west. Every year they try to move it around a little bit. They did two years straight in Chicago.
In Chicago, that's correct.
Uh-huh. The facilities were so great.
Great facilities.
But what I saw in Baltimore and in Atlanta looked pretty good, too.
Mm-hmm.
These hotels know how to do these conferences.
Yeah, it's done professionally. It certainly is.
Mm-hmm. So we're going to talk about the Digital Communications Conference for a bit, and then we're going to talk about digital communications for a bit. Because we had a great conversation in Dayton with the fellow you brought over that I had never heard of, that I'm now chagrined that I'd never heard of, Bruce. Bruce Perrins,
K6BP.
BP, mm-hmm. Who's very deep into the open source movement, into promoting codec 2, digital voice on HF and VHF and everywhere that we can squeeze some HF.
Very good evangelist for whatever he does.
He's coming up with supporting the move to come up with a software-defined radio handheld.
Yes.
All kinds of interesting stuff and future think. In ham radio.
Right. Yes, he is.
So, and we're going to be fighting the PA system. They're going to be doing the Young Ham of the Year. Mm-hmm. So it's going to be very busy behind us. We need to stay right up on our microphones.
Right.
So the Digital Communications Conference is easy to find out about, because two of the 4 years that I've shot it are now online.
Yes, they are. And we have archives for a lot of others, too. And, a lot of the talks are on the website, on TAPR.org websites. And you go back a number of years, I think, clear back in the mid-80s.
Are mostly like audio, not video.
Mostly audio, yeah. We only have a few video, which yours are outstanding.
Yep. So, but generically, they are people make presentations. They've been working on a project for a year or maybe several years.
Yeah, several years. And people from all over. It's an international conference. And they're there to promote what they've been working on and show people their ideas and new innovations, and hopefully inspire others to do the same.
So, and the thing they have in common is that they are somehow digital.
Yes. Yeah.
Not necessarily digital voice. You're the spokesman for digital voice.
Right.
But it... All things D.
Yeah, sure.
I've heard that title
We've
somewhere.
We've had developers of WinLink speak there a couple of times, Rick, and it's open to whatever new digital product that you want to show.
The P in TAPR. Mm-hmm. Well, the T stood for Tucson. They're not in Tucson anymore.
Right.
The A is amateur. It's still amateur.
Right.
The P is packet. And that's still there.
It's not the main focus
anymore.
Yeah, it's still there. APRs is definitely still everywhere. Find it everywhere. And there's still developments going on in TAPR. And the guy that started that, he speaks just about every year about some. Bob's always got some new idea.
Yeah, WB for APR. What is coincidence? APRS matches his call sign.
Yeah, yes. yes, it does.
One of those reverse...
Right.
Forget what. Yeah. Anyway. And then the R finally is radio. So the A and the R are still fundamental, and the P is still there. And the only thing we've lost is the T.
Right. But we refer to as TAPR now because it's more than just packet radio, as we just discussed. So normally when you talk about TAPR.
It's like KFC, not Kentucky Fried Chicken anymore, just KFC.
Right.
IBM is not International Business, so it's TAPR.
Right.
So the conference is 3 days, or 2.5 days, Friday, Saturday, Sunday.
Right.
Sequence of presentations.
Friday, it starts out about 9 o'clock, and there's presentations all day until about 4 o'clock. And we also have a demonstration room. If you bring your project, you can show, you know, what you've been working on. You have a place, you know, to put it out on tables. And
whether you're doing
display.
A talk on it or
yeah,
not.
Yeah, whether you're doing a talk or not, you can bring those. So that goes on both days as well. And Saturday, again, another day of presentations. And then we have a banquet on Saturday evening with a banquet speaker, and usually someone well-known in the industry. And there's been a lot of those. I'm not sure who that is this year. I don't believe it's been announced. But it will be on the TAPR website, along with the schedule of speakers, too. Probably on there, maybe by this weekend, I'm not sure.
Yeah, they don't announce all that way far in advance. But people still make plans to go.
Right,
they know they're going to see something good.
You can look back in the archives and see, you know, what's been done before and, you know, some of the subject matter. But there's always something new brought out every year, something that's kind of outstanding and inspiring. So that's what I like about it.
Yeah. Are you slated to give a talk this year?
Yes. I'll do another introductory talk on 3DV, a digital voice. And
we'll talk more about that in a minute, so I don't have to get all the details yet. So you'll be one of the... there's an intro track as well, separate room.
That's on Saturday.
Mm-hmm. People could travel cross-country for that. I'm not sure people would. That probably attracts hams in the local area.
It is. Usually it's about some subjects that are relatively new or new. They know nothing about and have some interest, you know, some new mode or something. D-Star, of course, has been one of those that has been an introductory message for several times. So.
Yep. Yeah. But there's what Steve calls the traveling circus, I think. There's a core group of people who go to the DCC wherever it is.
Yeah. It's definitely a place to do some networking.
Yeah. Then it attracts another group of local hams who have an interest in it. So the audience, the live audience, is a mix of people that show up every year from everywhere, and then the local hams who are taking advantage of the fact that it's come to their area.
Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of people that show up for this, especially Seattle. I remember 150 people or so. So it's a pretty good conference when you've got that many.
Technical corridor
technical
areas.
Technical right. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So if you haven't... been to a TAPR conference and your interest lies in those areas and you're going to be on the West Coast or want to travel, not too late. Even by the time this program comes out, it won't be too late.
It's actually in SeaTac, Washington. Into Washington. It's at a really nice hotel, and I understand they have a lot of good food, so that's always attracting too.
Yeah, hams and food are always a big deal.
Yeah.
I'm hearing the cheering. I think they're doing the award for Patrick there.
Right.
He's a very digital guy.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, he said he was an analog guy.
Maybe a CW guy.
Well,
was he in CW ops?
He liked HF a lot. And he does computers and all that stuff. But we're talking about what gets him interested in ham radio as the official representative of his generation.
Mm-hmm.
And he's an analog guy.
Great.
Not all the digital stuff. So.
But nothing wrong with that.
He'll do both. He'll be doing both. So the place to go, the easy place to go to figure out if you want to go do this, the TAPR website, TAPR.org, which I would dial up on my laptop here, but I can't get my internet connection working at the same time as my connection to the system here. And I've got it sitting on a page I want to show.
It's right on the front, HTML, right in the front page, so index page.
Yeah.
So easy to find.
Cutoff for registration is approximately when?
I don't know that.
That's going to be in early September.
I've already submitted mine some time ago, but probably in the next several weeks. I mean, it's still pretty late, another month or so.
You can walk in.
Yeah, you can certainly walk in, right. And you can walk in for a Friday or a Saturday or both.
Yeah.
Or the Sunday seminar, that's optional too.
It's not a HamFest price. It's not even a Dayton HamFest price. Dayton's like $25 or so to get into now. It's more close to $100.
Yeah, if you take everything, I think it's about $90 this year, something like that.
Yeah, and that, and then there's they feed you Saturday night.
Yeah,
that, that includes a banquet. So
yeah,
So it's not exorbitantly expensive. You'll spend more for a night in the hotel,
right,
than the event itself. But if you live out there, if you're a Seattle area ham who wants to come, don't expect it to be $5.
Right.
It's going to cost you.
Yeah.
In Chicago, there was one very disgruntled ham who made a lot of noise about how much it cost when he never had bothered to find out what the deal was.
Well, as you know, these are fairly expensive to put on. So,
oh, yeah.
You know.
Well, you know, I
but
know.
It's very educational. I mean, you're going to learn something.
Yep.
From that. So,
although I do the video and put it up for everybody to see, there's value in being there in person far beyond what you can get from watching the video.
As I mentioned earlier, the network and the people that you see there come up to and shake hands and talk about maybe your idea with them and get some help right there.
Yeah,
you know, it's worth that.
When I'm out there, I see that all the time.
Mm-hmm.
It's always going on.
Right.
Even when other talks are going on, people are out in the hallway.
That's right.
Figuring things out.
Right.
And I've seen progress made on various aspects of ham radio and stuff that people were puzzled about how they were going to go about doing it. And they met someone who had been there or had another idea.
Yes.
And they sat and talked and you know, drew it on napkins.
Right.
And products
That's
came
right.
out of it.
Yeah.
So it's pretty cool.
Right.
Let me talk about my video part for a minute.
Okay.
Because I did the video in Chicago for 2 years. It moved out to Portland, Oregon in 2010, and I didn't go because I'm based in North Carolina. I'm in Raleigh, and that was just a long way to go and too expensive. Mm-hmm. And I was a little frustrated that for 2008, 2009, I'd been selling DVDs of the conference. And 2008 did okay. I sold just under $10,000 worth.
Mm-hmm.
I considered the value of my time and energy to go do it and then all the editing and stuff that I did to be in the $12,000 to $15,000 range.
Mm-hmm.
So I thought, well, okay, but you know, you're giving back stuff to ham radio, so that wasn't too bad.
Sure.
2009 got worse. It was more in the $5,500 to $6,000 range. That could be the presentations that year were just not as interesting to an audience, or we were in recession, you know, there's all kinds of reasons.
Sure.
But I couldn't go in 2010 because it was going to be too expensive. Then in 11, it was in Baltimore, which is an easy drive for me. So I went up there and did that. And I thought, I'm going to put them online. Because online, they'll get a much, much bigger audience.
Yeah.
Instead of selling a couple of hundred DVDs, thousands of people will be able to watch. Thousands of people did.
Mm-hmm.
Dozens of people sent some money.
Well, so I did. Remember, this is ham radio.
Yeah. So then that first year, compared to the 95, almost 10,000 from selling DVDs and then 6,500, these were the first things I put online. It was before Ham Radio Now began. It was under my title of ARVN, Amateur Radio Video News.
Mm-hmm.
And so it was the only thing that I was collecting money for, and it was like $2,500 from an audience that was 10 times bigger than what had seen the DVDs. Something that was a quarter of the income. So that was bad. So, of course, I did it again in Baltimore. Of course I did. Well, in Atlanta, because Atlanta was also another easy drive and not too expensive for me. But this year we're back out again in Seattle on the West Coast. It's going to be expensive, and these things take a lot of time to edit and get going. I probably spend a month of you know, solid 40-hour weeks. It's distributed across more time than that.
Yeah.
I eke out the last couple of programs sometime in the end of January.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a lot of time involved, and so I do, and I can't personally afford to do this. I can't subsidize it. I don't have the bank account. I'm not rich. Not even close. So I have to be compensated for it. I almost feel bad because a few of the people making presentations at a TAPR conference are commercial. They're selling a product or they're involved with a company that sells a product. You'll have a talk talk from a guy from Flex will be there.
Yeah, yeah. Generally, that's because of there's some new innovation in that.
Yeah, but a lot of the guys,
but
they're just doing stuff because they love to.
Yeah, right. But, and they're all hams, too.
Yeah, and they're not making any money from it. Or if they are, they're selling circuit boards and stuff at barely above cost.
Right.
So I almost feel bad asking to be paid for what I'm doing. But on the other hand, I can't can't anymore do it. So this year, if you've been watching Ham Radio Now, you know I've got this Kickstarter started. Cliff, take the computer screen for a second here. That's what we're up to right now. That's live as of a half hour ago when I made my last internet connection. $2,700. We're going until September 2nd, Labor Day, is the end of the Kickstarter. So from today, you won't be seeing this for a few days. It won't be online. But from today, the Saturday of Huntsville, 16 days to go, and $10,000 goal. And back to me now, Cliff. I'm the director. Cliff is the technical director. It's an all or nothing thing. If I don't make the 10,000, I get zero, and I can't go. I literally can't go, much as I would want to, because the bank account is not there to support it. So you've made a substantial contribution. A bunch of people have. 54 people are going up to $2,700 is a lot from a lot of people, but it doesn't have to be a lot from a small number of people. It can be a small amount from a lot of people.
Yeah, that's what's needed.
Yeah, and the hard thing for me, the most important thing for me, is to have you, a viewer who thinks this is a good idea and is willing to support it, get the word out every place you can to other hams who also think this is a good idea and might support it. Now, the idea of spam is bad. The idea of trying to twist people's arms and get them to do things they're not interested in doing, I don't want to do that at all. But I do want every ham who might benefit from watching these videos, even hams who go out to the shows. Going out to the shows gets you one pass of what somebody's presenting.
Yes,
watching the video afterwards, mm-hmm. you can understand what they were talking about.
Right.
You can
right.
actually learn something.
Right. So play it back over and over if you need
yeah.
to get the details.
So it's worth going out in person. It's worth mm-hmm. having the video.
Mm-hmm.
So we're trying for the Kickstarter.
Yeah. yeah.
And we'll see.
TAPR
we'll
certainly
see.
Hopes you can make it.
Yeah.
That's for sure.
Me too. So that's that end of things. Is there anything else about the DCC that we ought to be talking about?
No, other than we invite everyone to come, and we hope to see them there.
Yep. Yeah, it is mostly high level stuff that, from my perspective, I learn a lot when I edit, because I pick up something every time I go through these mm-hmm. these presentations.
Mm-hmm.
But most of it, as I'm watching it for the first time, is over my head. I don't have the technical background.
Yeah, some of it is.
But not everyone, and some of them are just very operational. Some of them
right.
are how we use this digital stuff.
Exactly.
I understand
mm-hmm.
those fine.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And then the introductory programs are designed for people that
exactly.
don't have a deep technical
right.
background.
Right.
So
they're to learn how to use whatever it is, piece of software, hardware, whatever.
Yeah. And most of us are users.
Mm-hmm.
Only a few people develop stuff.
Right.
Most of us are users. You don't actually develop
again,
anything
that's
yourself.
That's what's unique, though. There's a lot of developers there. You know, there are the people that you can walk up to and ask a question you have about their program,
yeah.
and they can answer it for you.
And it's going to do a lot of good for them, because they're
right.
starting to understand how their users are,
right.
are working with it.
Right.
And in the developer community, users are sometimes a bit of a dirty word.
Mm-hmm. Well,
you know what I'm talking about.
They need them, though.
Yeah.
yeah.
Well,
yeah.
It's a love-hate relationship.
All, yes.
you know, yeah. on Ham Radio Now, we try to tell it a bit like it is. You know, we're not sugarcoating it, kid.
Mm-hmm.
That dichotomy exists in a lot of areas of life. I lived in a tourist town in Lake Havasu City, Arizona. Lake Havasu City loved the tourists. Lake Havasu City hated the tourists.
Yeah.
you know, same difference.
Yeah.
So people who design things, their users can be a major pain in the butt, but they're
mm-hmm.
but they're a necessary
mm-hmm.
pain in the butt, because
right.
they either pay for it or support it, and a substantial portion of the users ask the right questions and get the developers on a track they needed to
right.
maybe
well,
shift.
A lot of times
bit.
It does help the developers; they see that another side, you know, that they haven't seen.
Yeah.
That's so
you fall
them.
In that a lot too, because you're not
yeah.
writing the software
no,
and code
I'm not
and stuff.
Writing.
You're
mm.
a big supporter, and you're telling
right.
people
yeah.
how things work.
Right. Yeah.
I'm giving
I,
you an
I
option to talk more, because I'm doing half. Mine doing too much of the show.
No, I agree with you. I really enjoy doing that, and I have a group of guys that I work with. We call our test team, And we've done a lot to support digital voice over the years, and we're going to continue to do that because we love the mode and we think it has a bright future in ham radio.
Yep, so there'll be some of that out at the TAPR conference.
Yes, yeah, definitely.
So
yeah.
We talked with Bruce and you a lot, 2 hours worth just about, at at Dayton. I'm not sure there's been very much development in the digital voice scene.
Well, there continues to be work on the program itself, and there's still the goal there to have a program that's as robust as single sideband or better, so that means it's going to be working 0 dB or less of noise. That's definitely a goal that David Rowe has, and I'm sure he's going to accomplish it. And since Dayton, we've had...
David Rowe is the guy who wrote Codec 2.
Right.
And he's Australian.
Yes. And since then, Dayton, he has had a couple of more releases, one just recently. And we continue to see improvement, you know, a steady growth of the program and of users. And we have a site to help people get on the air, a free DV QSO finder where people can meet and chat back and forth and find a frequency to work on. And that's been very helpful in the growing of the mode. So I think that's going to continue as well. So it's doing good, slowly but surely.
You're going to get there. More people getting on the air?
It's kind of a cycle. It's a new release will come out, and a whole lot of people come on to see, you know, what came on new. And, you know, maybe they're happy and they stay and they continue. And others say, well, I'm going to wait till we see. We're still in beta. You know, a lot of people maybe a little scared of beta software and what it might, quote unquote, do to their PC or something. I don't know what their finish is over that. But anyway.
There has been no evidence of this software causing problems for anyone's computer.
Oh, none whatsoever. No.
But if you got a problem with that, run it in a sandbox.
Why we have, you know, we do all this testing before.
Yeah.
You know, across all these platforms, the Linux, Apple, all of the Microsoft OS and stuff. So it's pretty well tested, even though it's beta, before it hits the website to download it. So that's worked out quite well, I think.
It is available to anybody.
Yes.
It is free.
Free at freedv.org.
And the codec, I was a little unclear about this as I was putting together the program from Dayton. Mm-hmm. You don't download the codec by itself.
No, it's
codec
all, it's
is
all
part
in
of FreeDV.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's actually three parts, the graphics user interface that kind of glues everything together, and the modem, the FDM, frequency division multiplex modem, and the codec too. Those are all part of FreeDV.
And from there, it's very much like the old Digital Voice for Amateur Radio program that you and I did back in 1926.
Mm-hmm.
You connect a sound card from your computer through a rig blaster or any one of those interfaces.
And put on a set of USB headset.
Yep, and into the microphone connector and out of the accessory audio, audio in and out of HF sideband radio.
Right.
Turn off all the processing, no compressor, no ALC if you can avoid it. Most can't turn off the ALC, but you turn your mic gain down so it doesn't go into effect.
Mm-hmm.
Run your RF gain, your RF power down to about maybe 25%.
Right.
And your computer is feeding audio tones into your microphone that are the encoded voice that you have talked into your
sound
computer.
Sound card does the A to D, and then into the codec modem.
Yep. On the other end, out of the speaker, into a computer. Right. Not reading text on a screen anymore, although there's a little bit of that. It's part of it. And you're hearing a voice come out the other end.
Right.
With a much higher signal-to-noise ratio than we are experiencing here at the HamFest. Even with these great high
mics. It's capable now of carrying on a conversation in 3 or 4 dB.
Well, I'm talking about I'm talking about the audio that's coming
out
of your speaker.
Oh, the audio. That's totally silent.
Yeah, 50 dB or more.
Right, yeah. Yeah,
and you know we have background noise around here that's 20 dB below our best attempts to shout over it.
Yeah, there's no noise, so the fatigue has gone way down.
Yeah, but then you were talking about the RF
signal the RF to noise. Part. Yeah, to be able to receive a signal like we're talking about with no noise, no interruptions, we need about 3 or 4 dB signal noise ratio to do that. And so our goal is to get that to zero or below.
You remember
3 to 4 dB, if you listen to 3 to 4 dB in sideband, that's pretty noisy signal. So we're already, in my opinion, about there now.
You remember a talk back at Dayton, I think 2007, maybe 2006.
Mm-hmm.
You were part of the talk. I had it in my program. And I'm trying to remember the name of the guy that gave the talk. I know it real well. He said there's two things you need to remember about digital voice. Or think two things you need to remember.
Oh.
One, ice cream melts. and two, digital voice needs a lot of signal.
Yeah, but that was then. That's not now.
Ice cream still melts.
There's definitely a big difference now. When then you needed about an S9 signal. Now you need about an S5 signal. That depends, of course, on your noise floor. But if you can get an S unit or two above the noise level now, you're copying.
Yeah, and what you're copying is a signal that sounds almost like FM.
Almost.
Or maybe even almost better.
Not better yet, but
well,
yes.
Well, fidelity is not better.
Yeah, the fidelity is not better, but the intelligibility is there, and that's the main thing. You can understand the person.
The signal to noise is better than FM.
Right.
But the voice has that robotic...
A little bit.
Yeah, you know, C3PO.
Not much, though. You can definitely, it's the point where you can tell who you're talking with. I mean, you know, you're
that is a
voice.
Bit of faint praise.
Right.
Yeah. I can tell who you are.
Yeah.
I can't tell whether the any difficulty I'm having is from the digital signal or my old Alzheimer kicking in.
True. Well, that's helped with the ability to have your call sign printed out at the bottom, too, in your name or location.
I could use that for some of these interviews.
Right. So.
All right, so that's going along, and David keeps kicking out the updates on codec 2. But it's still considered to be beta.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. But it was alpha not too long ago, so I guess beta is better.
Yeah, it's coming. And it was late last year when it was first released, so you know that's not too long ago. So
it's
coming.
There are people who consider all commercial software to be beta.
Right.
We're Microsoft's beta testers all the time.
Exactly.
None of this stuff comes out perfect. Mm-hmm. It's very usable now.
Yes.
So.
Yeah.
And if you're set up for PSK31 or one of the other digital modes through a sound blaster.
Just add the headset and adjust your level for your microphone and your ears.
Yep.
And away you go.
Operation can be found where?
On the 14236 is kind of our water hole. Log on to the FreeDV QSO finder, and from there... You have a list of frequencies and a list of people. You can even click on their call sign and find out who, you know, has a logbook lookup. And so you can find out who's on, and then you can chat with them, ask them, you know, you want to try this frequency, if you want to try another band. We've got a whole list of them from 10 meters to 75 meters, different frequencies that we recommend to use. But you can use it anywhere, of course, in the sideband segment.
Nobody's using it on VHF yet.
There's other people experimenting with it, using different modems on VHF. Yeah.
Okay.
Yes,
so it's not exclusively the province of.
No, it's very early stages, but yeah, it's been shown. As you remember, we showed a video of a fellow that had his system working, and that was. For VHF.
But, okay.
Yeah, eventually, and it's going to be in the handy talk of the future, too. You know, HT, handheld, so.
Is it, how far in the future is that handy talk?
Well,
They said a working prototype next year.
Yeah, I think so.
We'll see if they do it.
Yeah.
That would be cool.
Yeah, Chris is doing really well with that, too.
Yeah, now he gave a talk at last year's TAPR, and that's online to watch.
Right.
This was my first concept of a handheld software radio. It's in my hand.
Yeah. Bruce is going to be speaking about that, too, in Seattle.
So Bruce will be there.
Yeah. So.
Excellent.
We'll hear more about that.
How synced in are you on some of the other digital modes? I know you've had D-Star stuff.
Mm-hmm.
W5KUB is behind us here.
It's
going to show us in the background here.
All right.
How synced in are you in some of the other digital modes? You've operated D-Star.
You mean like multi-PSK 16 and
no,
you know,
the voice modes.
Oh, and voice modes?
Yeah. I mean, there's, I don't know if you call it controversy, but there's,
you know, like,
I mean, if there's hams, there's controversy.
Like Motorola's?
Yeah. Yeah.
No, I haven't used that.
Okay.
So there's really nothing in my area. You know, there's no repeaters, so I haven't played with that. I haven't spent the money to buy an HD to try it. I really don't intend to.
Okay.
Be honest with you.
I was digging in with Bruce on the concept of how much longer any closed source at all digital system has before mm-hmm. open source is going to take over.
Mm-hmm.
And that would be D-Star and P25 and Moto Turbo. All those are relying on the same chip or the same family of chips for their vocoding that is closed.
Mm-hmm.
And and that locks the technology at the state it was when the stuff was developed. Unless
mm-hmm.
manufacturer decides to update their chips. With the open source stuff, it's going to be continually updatable. So this is, you know, is philosophical as it is technical, I suppose.
Yeah.
But what, you know, what's going to happen with digital voice where it has a foothold on VHF and D-Star and P25 Motor Turbo?
Well,
where are we going?
I don't know. I mean, I think it,
come on,
it,
Mel,
it,
tell it, me. I want to know.
You know,
I want an answer.
My forte is an HF, to be real honest with you. And I've operated D-Star, and I kind of like it, but we use it. The HF guys use it.
By the way, we're right behind the ICOM booth, so don't talk very loud.
Several of us have D-Star. And the DV dongles, which work well, and we kind of use them. We think of it as an intercom, as a talkback frequency for our HF. And we'll get on there, and, you know, we'll talk about things. And so we'd use it.
Is there a reflector that the HF digital voice guys use for talking around the country?
The Missouri Digital Group, we have a repeater in St. Louis, and that's the one we use.
Okay.
147.015.
So you're not getting on D-Star nationwide as a back channel for HF.
We could.
But what a great idea.
We thought about doing something like that. Yeah. Yeah, that's a good idea. We could do that. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, it's cool stuff.
Yep.
Now I'm sounding like Bob Heil. Well, that's cool. it's a brain filler. You say mm-hmm. that when mm-hmm. you're not ready to ask your next question.
I haven't gotten Bob interested in it yet, but... he's still right. It all starts at the microphone. And like these mics that we're using work best on digital voice. Because that digital voice, you need to close talk the mic. You need to keep all background noise out. And, the PR40 series, that does it.
I'll give you the advantage of that. Talking into the front of the microphone?
Talking into the back. I'm talking just as loud.
Couldn't hear me because I was talking into the back. What a way.
Yeah.
That's what helps us keep the noise down here. So thank you, Bob. I appreciate the technology. Even though you do have a hard time coming up with the next question and just say, oh, that's cool, that's cool. All right, well, we've probably gone about as far as we can go here.
I appreciate it very much.
I'm hoping very much to see you out in Seattle.
Yeah, we want to see you there,
Switch
Gary.
To my page here again. There we go. Stop by. You can get there from hamradionow.tv. And you'll see the Kickstarter symbols all over the place. And you'll get to the Kickstarter page. And it's not hard to make a contribution to the Kickstarter. And once again, you won't be charged if we don't make that $10,000 goal. But hopefully we'll be able to get there. And thank you, Mel, for contribution.
You're welcome.
Yeah. And all of the stuff that you are doing to promote the future of amateur radio.
Thank you, Gary.
I'll see you. If not in Seattle, maybe on Skype. And I've got my antenna back up. You might hear me on 14236. You got some digital neighbors on around 14236, right?
Yeah, we do. Yeah.
What's next door?
Fellas that send pictures back and forth on 14233.
Yeah. Digital pictures on 233 and analog pictures on 230.
They've got some new modes now, so they're not... Their pictures are much shorter.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
Is there a crossover in these groups? Do they
Yeah.
Any interest in doing the voice?
Yeah, we have guys that send pictures and also on digital voice, several of them. I do it myself. Yeah, it's a lot of fun.
Okay.
Yeah.
So, because it would seem like you got all the hardware and everything.
Sure. And they understand, they're probably the easiest one to set it up. So, it's pretty natural for them.
It makes sense.
Yeah.
All right. Hopefully, I'll see you in Seattle.
All right.
That's it for this episode of Ham Radio Now. From the Huntsville Ham Fest, I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ 73's, everybody. Over and out.